is it maybe a part of evolution that people are getting more individual, more developing yourself more instead of group behavior?
Well, we need other people because we're way more effective with them. You know, you with other people, you get division of labor and specialization and then cooperation and trade. And that's unbelievably beneficial. And so, and that makes us engage in reciprocal behavior, you know, fair play, for lack of a better word. And so part of the reason that we're so group oriented is because it's so advantageous. Plus, we also have to raise families, and human infants are very dependent for a very long time. And so it actually takes a certain amount of collective effort to ensure that we can propagate. So there's all sorts of good things about our social capacity, but it has dangers. And the danger, one of the big dangers, is that we can devolve quite rapidly into a narrow tribalism. And the danger of that is, well, the increased probability of intergroup violence. And it's something we always have to be careful about, because it can happen very rapidly and can degenerate very rapidly. And treating each other as individuals is one of the ways that we forestall that proclivity, which is why I'm not happy about the identity politics types, because they keep insisting that tribal identity is of paramount importance. And that's a recipe for disaster as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, and they dictate what you should think, how you should think, how you express yourself, how you address others, how you should address others, which is weird to me. I really like your this quote of yours, and that is, in order to think, you have to risk being offensive.
Yeah, well, you have to even risk offending yourself. I mean, imagine that you have a pet idea that you're emotionally attracted to, you know, but you're not sure it's a good idea, and so you have to think it through. Well, to do that, you have to set up opponents in fiction, in your imagination, and let those opponents hammer away at your pet idea. And if you think that isn't going to upset you, then you haven't experienced true thinking, because true thinking is a very emotionally upsetting experience. Just like true dialogue is emotionally upsetting if you're actually discussing a complex problem.
Right.
I mean, if the problem is complex, it's often the case that people, even who are positively predisposed to each other, have a hard time even laying out all the options on the table, even if they don't feel that they're necessarily going to implement them. Because it's so upsetting to think of all the complex alternatives that might lay in front of you if you're faced with a complex problem. Or worse, that maybe you're conceiving the problem incorrectly. So
yeah.
Thinking is by nature, especially when you're thinking about difficult problems, thinking is by nature something that is destabilizing in the short term, because it undermines certainty. Now, if your certainty is false, then you better undermine it, because if you act on a false certainty, then you're going to be in trouble. But that doesn't mean the process of thinking is anything but disruptive.
Thinking is actually questioning everything. Is that what you mean?
Well, it can be, but it's at least questioning some things, and it's at least questioning some things of desired value. Because if you're not questioning anything of desired value, then, well, you're not thinking about anything important. So thinking is offensive by its nature, at least in the short term. It's emotionally disruptive. And so you can't have, if you forbid dispute, competitive dispute, then all that's left for people is to nod and agree with each other, even if they're faced with a serious problem. And that's a very, very bad idea.
Well, you are being perceived as one of the bigger thinkers of our time. What drives you? Why? You say thinking is also very agonizing. It's
not as agonizing as not thinking. That's the only thing. But the time course is different. Thinking is agonizing in the short run, but really useful in the medium to long term. And I'm very aware of that. And so I'm willing to engage in conflictual thinking if I believe there's a true problem, because I'd rather see the problem solved so that peace and harmony can reign. And what drives me is a desire to fortify the individual against the dangers of totalitarian tribalism.
That's
what I've been trying to do in all my teaching and most of my academic work, not all of it, because I've researched a variety of different domains, but I've been trying to do that as an educator and as a clinician for 35 years. This is just an extension of that. I like to see people become more resilient and robust and courageous and noble and responsible and mature. And I think every time a single person manages that, that the world measurably tilts away from hell and towards heaven. So right. That's what motivates me. I mean, I've read the literature on the catastrophes of the 20th century very deeply and took it to heart, and certainly believe that part of the reason that, well, what happened to your family in World War II was that individual citizens didn't do their duty when they were called upon to, and they let the tyrannical identity politics fascist types dominate, and then we got hell. And I don't want there to be more hell.
No.
So I'm hoping that individuals can clue in and wake up and adopt a proper mode of being, one that's associated with responsible citizenship, let's say, and that will fortify us against the recurrence of such catastrophes.
Yes. I saw you on a Norwegian talk show a couple of days ago, and you were talking about the equality between men and women, I think. They were looking at you with such confusion, and I know they looked very insecure about what you were saying, because it felt like they'd never heard before that women are actually biologically different than men, and it was very hard for them to swallow that information. And you said,
"Look, well, it's worse than that. Actually, I was pointing out something that was even worse. It's a fatal flaw in the radical egalitarian's worldview. All of the evidence, okay, so imagine that you're looking for equality of outcome, okay, so that would be every occupational division was occupied by group members in precisely the same proportion as they exist in the general population.
Yeah.
So, okay, so first of all, that's impossible because there's so many different ways of slicing people into group identities, but we'll leave that aside for a moment. Not only do you want equality of representation at the outcome level, but you also want to ensure that everyone who's doing the same job, whatever that same means, is paid exactly the same amount of money, is given the same amount of value.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's one set of desires.
That's real equality.
And on the other set of desires, you want everybody to have as much opportunity to make whatever choices they want to make freely without constraint.
Yeah.
Okay, you can't have both of those. Because what happens is that if you set up your society so that people's choice is maximized in the absence of societal pressure, let's say, which we could say has happened to some degree in countries like the Scandinavian countries and in the Netherlands, where some recent research has been conducted and published, then what happens is that you maximize certain differences of outcome instead of minimizing them.
Because of choice.
So you can't have equality of opportunity and equality of outcome at the same time. Well, and that's a catastrophe for the radical left because they want both.
Yeah.
So, and it's not technically possible. Yeah. So,
And it's very simple too. Like biologically, men are programmed differently than women. They like things. You said they literally like stuff, things. Women like people. You know, more interested.
On average, that's the case. I mean, there's a fair bit of overlap. It's not like there are no women that like things and no men that like people. There's a fair bit of overlap, but a lot of the occupational sorting happens at the extremes. So, for example, for engineers, that's a good example. If you're going to be an engineer, which is actually rather rare, you're going to be one of the people who is in the top 5th percentile of those who like things. And if you're going to be a nurse, you're going to be in the top first 5th percentile of those who like people. And so almost all of those people are going to be male in the first case and female in the second case, even though men and women are more the same than different. The differences are magnified at the extremes, and a lot of the selection takes place at the extremes.
Right.
And so, and good luck sorting that out. You know, and the Norwegian politician who was on with me, you know, she couldn't compute that because her fundamental presupposition was, well, if you just treat everybody the same to begin with, then the outcomes will be the same. It's like, nope, Wrong. That's not what happens. The difference is actually maximized rather than minimizing.
Yeah.
And people say, well, that's pseudoscience, you know, and it's like, no, it's not. Tens of thousands of subjects, multiple studies published in many, many journals.
Empirical.
By social scientists who wouldn't have hoped that that would be the outcome. So you can't even blame it on the bias of the scientists because it runs contrary to what they would have hoped for.
Right. I have a question for you. Do you believe in God?
Yeah. Well, I have a good answer to that, and that is that I act as if I do. But I think that's also a very good definition of belief, because if you're trying to determine whether or not someone believes something, do you listen to what they say or do you watch what they do?
Right.
And I would say the more accurate measure is what they do.
So the values, the Christian values is what matters, not if you believe or not.
Well, it's not so much whether you say that you believe, because that's a less valid marker. So, and you know, it's also in some sense, like, I'm not exactly sure why that question makes me recoil. I think it's because it always seems to me to be a sort of trap, that question. I think it's partly because when I'm asked that, I'm usually asked by someone who wants to immediately put me into a box of their convenient choosing.
No, not me.
So, no, well, that could be, but
I'm really, really, because you're a scientist, and it's like the devil's dilemma of scientists, you know, is there a God? Is there not a God? And if you're a scientist and you believe in God, how can you, you know, mix those two ideas? But I'm asking you, I come in peace, but I just wanted you to know, to ask you, because I'm really curious, you know, how do you feel as a scientist about...
Look, I think the idea that human beings are made in the image of God is an unbelievably powerful idea. I think it's a bedrock idea. It's maybe the bedrock idea of our culture.
Right.
I believe that part of the reason that we're made in the image of God, so to speak, so that language makes sense, is because part of what we do as conscious beings is participate in the process of generating reality from potential. So I believe that's an echo of the process that was outlined in the early verses of Genesis, because that's essentially what's accounted. And I believe if there's anything divine at all, I would say the consciousness and self-consciousness of each individual human being is something divine. And I believe also that that's associated with what is of highest value in being itself. And that's all essentially a religious viewpoint.
Yeah.
And it's conceivable to me that consciousness itself is reflective of something fundamentally divine about the nature of reality itself. It looks to me like that's the most appropriate conceptual scheme.
I think people are capable of doing divine things. Maybe you yourself, you know, you actually, you're very idealistic about your visions and ideas. But to me, it's very simple.
Well, people are certainly capable of great evil. So we should be able to assume that they're also capable of the opposite.
Great goodness, yeah. I think I visioned God, or the idea of God, as people giving each other energy. If I give you negative energy, it will immediately affect you. It will affect the rest of your day, maybe your wife or daughter. If I give you positive energy, it will also influence you. So that's a God-like thing you can actually...
participate in,
you know, and being very aware of doing that.
But yes, I mean, part of what you want to do is decide whether you're trying to make things worse or better.
Right.
And if you make them worse, you can make them worse at all sorts of levels, including the apparently trivial levels that you just described, your day-to-day interactions with people. But they aren't trivial. And you do tilt things up or down with each choice that you make. And so I also believe that the best way to conceptualize human existence is as engagement in the struggle, the eternal struggle, let's say, between good and evil, which is also fundamentally a religious conception.
Yeah. So, do you believe in evil?
Oh, definitely. I can't. I think that anyone who's taken the time to educate themselves about the horrors of the 20th century, to say nothing of the horrors of human history overall, you can't walk away from that without believing in the reality of evil. There's just not, I can't see how that's possible.
Not
the least.
What moves you today? What can make you... Well,
what moves me on a regular basis at the moment is this lecture series that I'm doing. I'm touring around the world and I'm talking to thousands of people about every second day, and the events are unbelievably positive, and all the people that are coming are there because they're trying to develop a vision for their life and to be more responsible and to tell the truth and to put their lives together and to take more responsibility for their family and their community. And then they, hundreds of them at these events, tell me how their life was a while back. Usually there was some problem of some sort with their family or with their ambitions or with their mental health. And then they tell me what they've been doing to improve things and that it's going way better and that they're thrilled to death and that everything's going and that everything is proceeding in a much more positive manner. And so that's, God, you can't get enough of that. That's just, and every time I hear someone say that, I think, excellent. That's one more person who's working to keep things away from degenerating into hell. And so that's another victory as far as I'm concerned. And I'm not a trivial one either. Because I do believe that each individual is the center of the world in some sense. And every time you have the privilege and good fortune to tap that center of existence into some form of more harmonious being, that's a major victory, a real victory, and a step forward in the eternal battle of good against evil. And that's probably a good place to stop.
Yes, it was. It was the best end quote. And I've taken way too much of your time. Thank you so much, Dr. Peterson.
Very good talking with you.
Again, a big honor. And if you come back to Holland, I would like to invite you into the studio so we can actually look each other in the eye and have a beer or something.
Well, I appreciate the invitation and also the opportunity to talk to you.
Lots of success with your endeavors. And I hope to talk to you very soon again. Thank you, Dr.
Thank
Peterson.
You. Thank you very much. You bet. Bye-bye.